Good morning, Atlantis, and good morning, Leland from the family.
Good morning, Archie. I'd like to say thank you to my sister and my family for letting us know that we are all family and we're working together here as a family. And thanks to my family and also the Mission Control family.
Taking a look on board Atlantis now is Mission Specialist Randy Brasnick there on the left and Leland Melvin there in the center of your screen begin the process of grabbing on to Express Logistics Carrier number 2. They're going to use the shuttle's robotic arm to latch onto it and begin the process of lifting it up out of Atlantis's payload bay. Eventually it will be handed over to the station's robotic arm, which will then install it on the station's structure.
Oh my God.
This is Mission Control Houston. You're taking a look live inside the Columbus Laboratory on board the International Space Station as STS-129 Commander Charlie Hobaugh and Expedition 21 Flight Engineer Jeff Williams work on what's called the HRF. This is the human research facility that resides inside that part of the station. It allows quite a bit of research to be done on the effects of long-duration spaceflight on the human body. There's an ultrasound that is part of that rack, and Williams and Hobaugh are currently swapping out some of the circuit boards on that rack, just basically refreshing them and putting in some new parts.
We can see Nicole Stott, now a shuttle crew member, getting ready to end her long-duration stay from the International Space Station, getting ready to head into the Colbert area so that she can do some exercise on the newest piece of treadmill equipment aboard the International Space Station, that combined operational load-bearing external resistance treadmill, named for comedian Stephen Colbert after he mounted a write-in campaign to name the Tranquility Module after himself, but the Tranquility Module instead chosen for the landing site of the Eagle, the first spacecraft to land on the human spacecraft to land on the moon. She's wearing a specially made harness developed at the Glenn Research Center in Cleveland, Ohio, that is going to allow her to work out more comfortably and therefore put more foot force down as she runs on the treadmill, which should provide more effective exercise as a countermeasure for the long-duration spaceflight effects that happen to the human body. Other crew members doing a variety of activities. Jeff Williams continuing his work to reroute cables and fluid lines to help prepare for the arrival of the next U.S. Module for the International Space Station. The Tranquility Module, as previously discussed, is scheduled to launch to the International Space Station on the next space shuttle mission, the STS-130 mission, that is scheduled for launch in February of next year, 2010. Bob Thirsk continuing his work with experiment equipment aboard the International Space Station and having an opportunity to take a look at the situation on one of the laptop computers. Thirsk scheduled to be getting EVA cameras ready for the turnaround so that the spacewalkers can use them again tomorrow. Tomorrow's spacewalk scheduled to include Mission Specialist Randy Brasnick and Mike Foreman. Those two will camp out in the Quest Airlock Module's equipment lock tonight overnight to acclimate their bodies to the lower pressures that they'll be experiencing in the spacesuits tomorrow.
Started out with ELC-2 grapple, getting ready for tomorrow's ELC-2 install. Comrade and I were moving the arm in an O-cast, pretty simple maneuver, got it there pretty quickly, and got the day started off right. Today was pretty much a transfer day, and kind of relaxed from yesterday's great EVA-1, getting ready for EVA-2. We also had some payload activity. Here's Scorch and I installing filters into the ABR system. That's one of the mid-deck payloads that we took up, and we're going to transfer that over to the station today to do some plant growth. And here's Bob Thirsk and I removing the launch bolts from the ABRs and about to transfer it over. Here's Bobby in the gym, working on the gym robotic arm. He's sitting here working at the robotics workstation, looking at the SSC. We have some great views out of the gym windows, the two windows there, the forward and the aft window. Just amazing, amazing views. Bobby is a robotics expert here. He's working the PCS and getting ready to move the arm. On getting it back to the stowed position after doing the Lee looping. And there's the gym arm out the gym window. It's beautiful. Bobby's becoming the lube master after all of this work. Pretty relaxing day, getting our batteries recharged for another central day tomorrow. Here's Nicole acting as Bobby's, I guess, J2. And while he's working the arm, getting it back to its position. Here we're transferring EMUs out of storage in Columbus back to the airlock. So here is Randy's EMU. Make sure we don't bump into anything, anyone, and rip off any computers for the robotics workstation or take anyone out. Making the turn into the airlock, and they're going to get it attached and ready to go for tomorrow's EVA. Securing it in the ETA.
Sound going.
Light goes off. All right, and then switch system power on the right side.
This is the HRF. Scorch replaced some of the boards, and they're now checking it out to make sure that everything is working properly.
Yep.
C, D, and G.
So you want to break it down or leave it up?
You know, I think I want to leave it up. I'll put the scan head away just because I let's leave it until we hear from them. Because, it's not a huge pain to put this thing together.
Okay. Got it working?
Yay, good job, you guys.
It's fixing. It's fixed.
All right, great.
Okay, here's Mike in the airlock getting things prepared for EVA 2. Here's Comrade, they're putting anti-fog in their helmet. Here's our illustrious commander getting ready to do some menial transfer, in charge of transfer, so I'm in charge of Scorch right now. Kind of a circuitous path to get down to the shuttle. Going through PMA-1 and from node 2. It's going to make a 90-degree turn, and then we head into the shuttle. This was a PAO event with ESPN and a couple of other stations, and Jeff's trying to get someone to throw a football in, mouthing it to one of the cameramen. This is how we play football in space. I'm sorry. Now, this is Comrade doing a little transfer, the RFTA. He's taken up into the top of the JLP. He's going to do a Superman move now. Football in space.
You're the duck.
One.
Good evening, Houston.
Forge.
Good evening, Houston. Good evening, Houston. Good evening, Houston.
That ends our flight day highlights, but I just want to say thank everyone on the ground for getting us ready and keeping us safe, And we had an off day today, but we're gearing back up tomorrow for a good day, and we'll be ready. All right, over and out.
Hey, Leland, I don't know about an off day. It looks like you guys were working pretty hard today. Nice job with all the arm ops to you and the whole arm team. Thanks for sharing those beautiful views out the window with us and letting us have a behind-the-scenes look at everything you guys are doing up there on Space Station. You're doing a great job. It looks like you're having a lot of fun. We enjoyed Randy's Superman and the football game as well. But it's been great working with you, and we'll look forward to another day tomorrow.
Good morning, Atlantis, and special good morning to you, Bobby.
Hey, good morning, Aki, and thanks again for the wake-up music, Voyage to Atlantis by the Isley Brothers. Just want to thank my wife, Nawana, again for that, and also my kids, Deja and Robbie. Thanks a lot.
This is Mission Control Houston. As you can see, the Express Logistics Carrier number 2 being lifted out of Atlantis' payload bay using the shuttle's robotic arm. Here shortly it will be handed off to the station's robotic arm. The team is going to hold the arm position where it is for a few minutes. This ELC is carrying more than 13,000 pounds of supplies that are due to be installed on the outside of the station's truss structure, just like ELC 1 was done right after Atlantis docked with the station back on flight day 3. The Express Logistics Carrier number 2 on the end of Atlantis' robotic arm is in motion once again. It's on its way to be handed off to the station's robotic arm. You're getting a good look at the entire size of this cargo carrier. It's 16 feet by 14 feet wide. And it's carrying 13,400 pounds of supplies. So the crew inside the Quest airlock continuing to work along through the procedures, getting ready to go for today's spacewalk. They're doing some communications checks between Mike Forman and Randy Bresnik, making sure that the ground here can hear them. All the crews inside getting ready to go. There's some robotics operations taking place between the station's robotic arm and the shuttle's robotic arm. You can see Express Logistics Carrier number 2 there perched on the end of Atlantis's robotic arm. It's about to be handed off to the station's robotic arm.
Pretty high.
Once that is complete, the station's arm will steer it over toward the what's called the upper outboard pass or payload attach system. This is a large cargo attachment point on the right side of the station structure. And that is where it shall remain with these very large spare parts contained on this cargo attachment point. This is taking a look at Express Logistics Carrier number 2, still waiting to be grabbed onto by the station's robotic arm, which is in progress. The station's arm is going to latch onto this ELC-2 and then move it out to the station's truss structure to attach it to one of the cargo attachment points out there. The destination for ELC-2 is going to be the upper outboard payload attach system, which is on the starboard truss, the right side of the station. Even though these twin express logistics carriers, number one and number two, have been inside Atlantis's payload bay once ELC-1 was installed after Atlantis docked out on the port truss, these two will now be split up because ELC-2 is going to be installed on the starboard truss, so they'll be on opposite ends of the station, and that is where they shall remain until their spare parts are needed throughout the life of the station itself.
For EVA prep.
Go ahead on 2 for EVA prep.
Okay, we are at step 5050 with CSAO2 readings of 26.2 and 25.9.
Okay, airlock on 2, we copy the numbers and concur.
And Atlantis's arm begins to back away from Express Logistics Carrier number 2 after the handoff in space has taken place. ELC-2 is now under the control of the station's robotic arm. It will now be moved over to its permanent position out on the starboard truss.
Station Houston on 1 for Jeff. We copy your starting up with step 3, and you can skip step 4 and go on to 5 as well.
Okay, step 3 is in work, and then we'll go to step 5 directly from 3.
Good read back. Airlock Houston on 2, we're ready for pressurization and hatch opening.
Once STS Commander Charlie Hobaugh, which you see there in the center of the screen, and Nicole Stott there on the right, get Mike Foreman and Randy Bresnik set up. They will move them inside that equipment lock there on the left and close the hatch. And then Stott and Hobaugh will move to the main part of the International Space Station. Today's intravehicular officer is going to be Bobby Satcher, who completed the first spacewalk of the mission with Mike Foreman. Satcher will be on Atlantis's aft flight deck looking through the windows there as the two spacewalkers conduct today's activities. He will serve as their eyes and ears and help them sort of coordinate all the movements and tasks that they have to take care of today. This is Mission Control Houston. The Quest airlock is continuing to be depressed with Mike Foreman and Randy Bresnik inside. It is currently holding at 5 PSI. This is part of the standard procedure. In just a few moments, they will continue the depressurization of this part of the station, and it will allow Bresnik and Foreman to open that hatch that you see at the top right center portion of your screen. Team here in Houston confirming that the hatch to the Quest airlock is now opened and latched back.
Looking at images from the International Space Station, where Atlantis astronauts are taking a walk on the outside. Well, we hope to be showing you those pictures. It's the first time spacewalker Randolph Bresnik is awaiting the birth of a daughter back on Earth. Mission Control won't tell him, though, if it happens during his spacewalk, so he can stay focused on the job.
Faulty alarm interrupted preparations for the spacewalk. Mike Foreman and Randy Bresnik will relocate a floating unit that measures electric charges, building up on the station, install a cargo attachment system, and set up a wireless video system to transmit images to the station and relay them to Earth. Bresnik, who is making his first ever spacewalk, is awaiting the birth of his daughter back on Earth. His wife was due to give birth to the couple's second child on Friday. If the child is born during the mission, Bresnik would be the only second person to become a father in space. One more spacewalk is planned for Atlantis' delivery mission before it returns on Wednesday.
The second of three planned spacewalks to tackle maintenance work outside the International Space Station. Earlier, a faulty alarm had interrupted preparations for the walk. Mike Foreman and Randy Bresnik will relocate a floating unit that measures electric charges. They'll install a cargo attachment system and also set up a wireless video system. Now, Mr. Bresnik is making his first ever spacewalk, but back on Earth, he's awaiting the birth of his daughter. His wife was due to give birth to the couple's second child on Friday. If the child is born during the current mission, Bresnik would become only the second person to become a father while in space. One more spacewalk is planned for Atlantis' delivery mission before it returns on Wednesday.
J02.
Houston on 2 for robotics. You're a go to power ELC2.
Leland, we copy. Thanks. Good job.
Is on 0935 against the aft stanchion. Project went on from starboard.
Okay, have you 0935 with the bracket on the aft edge? And just want to confirm it's also on the starboard side of the handrail?
It was put on from the starboard side.
Okay, great work, comrade. Okay, and ground, just want to once again check that you guys like that orientation.
Houston likes it, thanks.
This is the ARIS you're seeing right now, the amateur radio for ISS. This is the ham radio that they're installing on the outside of Columbus. You can see that it has five antennas on it.
Got a good cow, good volts. Alpha 2, clockwise 1.
Right, you're expecting 6 turns. You want to start with the aft bolt first.
Copy, aft bolt first.
And we'll get the torque reading at the end.
Okay, driving. Okay, Bobby, I'm ready for mate. I got good pins, good pod, jet, and good EMI band.
Okay, great work, Mike. You can go ahead and mate J02 to P02.
Good work.
This is Mission Control Houston. We're now 55 minutes into today's spacewalk by Mike Forman and Randy Bresnik. As you can see, the station's robotic arm being moved around quite a bit. It's going to perform a walk-off here shortly. It released the ELC-2 after successfully installing it a couple of hours ago. Bresnik and Forman making very good progress on today's spacewalk. Bresnik almost wrapped up with his tasks surrounding this gator assembly, these two antennas that he and Forman have installed in Columbus.
Okay, work,
Forman is wrapping
work,
up some wire ties and routing some cables through some handrails. It is most likely that Bresnik will finish up his tasks first. If that takes place, he will probably move on to this floating potential measurement unit, the FPMU relocation. Before Forman to go ahead and make the most efficient use of time.
Okay,
so we will stand by for that, but so far everything going extremely well.
Okay, thanks for that. Just check the work site, make sure that you have all your tools and the tethers are clear.
It looks like we are clear, everything is secured. Hey, Bobby, I got that strap in my tool bag.
Great work, and we'll get a glove check from you, Mike.
Hey, right glove looks good. Left glove looks great.
Outstanding. Okay, well, great work on the gator. Both of you are going to head back towards the lab to retrieve your airlock tether.
move on your next go here. As you swing around, you're real close to the top of the orbiter, so just make sure you either keep your feet out or stay tight. Be good.
Will do.
Good job.
Thanks, Butch. Time to leave Columbus. Auf Wiedersehen and ciao. And Bobby, I think we left Columbus better than when we came. So to all our friends at ESA, you can just say, do it, mi amigo paga.
That's impressive.
Houston, ISS on 2 for robotics.
Go ahead, David.
Copy.
We're now 2 hours and 21 minutes into today's spacewalk. You see Randy Bresnik there with the broken red stripes on the legs of his spacesuit.
You got room for one more? Sure.
Mike Foreman's in there. They're both recharging the oxygen on their spacesuits before they tackle the next task, which is the deployment of another one of these cargo attachment points on the outside of the station's truss.
I am.
They're making his way out onto the truss as well.
Hi, Bobby. I've got the large small red on 3014. Crew lock bag between 3015 and 3020.
Okay, copy. Crew lock bag is between 3015 and 3020, and the large small reps on 3014.
Yep.
Okay, comrade, you can start working on swiveling the deploy clevis bracket.
Copy. Okay, Bobby, what is stowed on 3030?
Copy, 3030. All right, Mike, you are the hinge line prep guy, so you're going to be removing the hinge line ADPs. There are two of them.
On my way, hinge line.
This is Mission Control Houston. All three of the ready-to-latch indicators working well on the payload attach system that's just been deployed on the Zenith inboard location of the starboard three truss structure of the International Space Station.
The Weta into the stanchion by sliding it along the guide pins into stop dock position.
Copy that.
Back now with live television from the helmet cameras of the two astronauts who are outside the International Space Station on this spacewalk, now 3.5 hours long.
Go ahead.
This is Mission Control Houston, watching the helmet camera of spacewalker Randy Bresnik. All of the connections now made to the wireless EVA television camera system on a stanchion on the structure of the station.
Yeah, Bobby, tell Scorch we like his idea. Let's go for the Nader inboard pass, and we'll reevaluate after that. See what else we have left, what else we can get done after that one. You guys are doing great, keeping way ahead. It's wonderful. Atlanta is Houston, big loop for EVA. We suggest Mike does the diagonal brace whenever he gets a chance.
I'm ready for settings on the diagonal brace.
Copy that. Bravo 6, counterclockwise 3.
Bravo 6, counterclockwise 3, 35, not to exceed 37.
Good read back.
Atlantis Houston's big loop for EVA.
Go ahead, Swanny.
Yeah, we'd like Mike to stop at 15 and evaluate again the cup cone, please.
Yeah, thanks for the reminder, Swanny.
Good plan, Swanny.
Hey, for Comrade Mike, if you guys want to take a couple minute break, we're going to go smoking right over top of Houston. You can wave.
Cool.
I'll let you know when we get there. Give you a few seconds heads up.
Thanks.
It's just STS 129's contribution to the station.
And we can publicly recognize Captain Mike Foreman, U.S. Navy. 3 passes and 2 EVAs.
Wire tie king and pass king.
What was the second part? Wire tie and pass king, Mike. Oh, wire tie and pass deploy, okay. Couldn't do it without you guys. About to do this one by yourself, Randy.
Comrade, a warning. There's a 2-foot keep-out zone for the P1 radiator beam, which begins just outboard of the P1 with 3.
Atlantis, Houston.
I'll take that call and get a little closer. Copy that. The other caution is avoid contact. P1 lower inboard camera.
Exactly.
And avoid inadvertent contact with grapple fixture. I'll do my best. And Houston, does Mike have a go to remake the connection?
Affirm he does.
Relay, Bobby.
You can remake the connector.
Hey. Yeah. There's one underneath my outfit, and let's reach next one. Good, Papa, Papa, Bobby.
So come around, come around, give us the final tool inventory.
This is a look from one of the external cameras on the International Space Station at the Quest airlock module. Mike Foreman already inside the airlock connecting up to hardline umbilicals. Randy Bresnik making his way back inside the crew lock hatch.
Additional adjustable. Trash bag. had a beep beep with a wreck. And I think that's it.
Hey, it's swinging back towards you now, comrade.
Tell your own, thanks. Nice job. You see the little Velcro tab there? It's kind of worn out.
Okay, you need, both of you need to remove the SCU storage pouch.
We've got a couple of guys here on the flight deck. We'll pass the mic around as we go through this. We're going to start off today with some comments and discussion with our ISS comrades. I think Bob first is going to start us off, so here we go.
This is our onboard stationary bike. We use it for a number of reasons. One obviously is to stay healthy. It's good aerobic conditioning. Our strength and conditioning coaches give us an exercise protocol and we work out on it almost every day. If not the stationary bike, then we work out on the treadmill. We also use it for EVA pre-brief. It's important prior to an EVA for our spacewalk crew member to get as much nitrogen out of their blood system as possible. And we can either do that with an overnight camp in the airlock where they're breathing at reduced pressure and strong, higher concentrations of oxygen, or if time is limited, like today, we can have the crew member exercise on the Cevas bike while breathing oxygen. The combination of exercise and also breathing oxygen helps to get rid of some of that nitrogen out of the blood. We'll be monitoring them while they're on the Cevas bike. It's important to get their heart rate up to a certain level so we know that they are working hard. This is a heart rate monitor. The crew members will be putting this around their chest. And then wearing this heart rate watch, which will monitor how fast their heart is beating. So we'll want to get them up to a certain level. I think it's for about 20 minutes or so.
Yeah. All right, thanks for that. And here is Nicole, who will be helping with the exercise protocol.
Good morning. We are here just outside of the airlock where we're going to be getting Mike and Randy ready to go out for EVA2. And today we're going to do a little something different with the exercise protocol. So they get the joy of riding on the bike for a little while, about 7 minutes, pumping real hard to get that oxygen flowing. And we have a really nice cue card here that we use to keep track of their loads on the bike and their heart rate and make sure that they work to the... Yeah, I know. I noticed. Mike has very nice loads.
He's a hard worker.
And,
no wimpy.
He's a machine. And so anyway, that'll get them all ready to go out for the EVA today.
Takes a big load to get my heart rubbed. Or just when Nicole gets my heart pumping too.
Old people.
Oh, well.
Yeah, old people. Okay.
Big loads.
All right.
That's good right there.
Oh, yeah. Ride it. Act like you like it, Butch.
An equal and opposite reaction. So when you're trying to push down on something, you gotta brace yourself somewhere, you'll float away. So that's what that was all about.
Roger.
It's roughly about an hour and a half, almost 2 hours.
He's got a couple of converts here.
Sort of the world's expert exercise protocol.
I don't know if I'd say that. I like exercise protocol, especially for from a station and expedition crew point of view. So I think this is a great opportunity to go back and do exercise. We haven't seen it in a while, and to show everybody and to demonstrate that it can be done safely and effectively. We fell into this opportunity, obviously, because of the alarm overnight, and it's going to go just fine. Looking forward to it.
All right, thanks.
All right.
C-1 is ready to be grappled by the SSRMS. My commander, Charlie Holball, was a flawless M2, R2. All right. What's next? Check the numbers. No.
Running amok.
There you saw my comm cap was working then. Didn't work so well after that, but fixing my hair a little bit. Comrade doesn't have that problem. You see Nicole and Butcher in there helping us out.
Getting ready to go out on his first EVA. He's in the airlock. He's getting ready to go in the suit. Mike's already in the suit.
All right.
Guys are looking good. Good to go.
We have the airlock at normal pressure here. coach is standing on my legs, holding my arms up, pushing me down. It's kind of hard to shake out of this thing. Doing the dance, Butch, doing the dance. Than it is to get out.
Handed it out.
How do you like exercise pre-breed?
Oh, I like it. Okay.
Better than Kappa?
Okay. Thanks, Bob.
Yeah. It seemed like a longer day getting out the door.
Well, that's because you started with Kappa. Broke Kappa.
You're going on the ground too for net making PMC.
And then finally get
long. Oh, I got you. Okay. Thank you.
Wear hair and makeup when you need them.
Not yet.
Translating back over to the shuttle.
Good morning, Atlantis, and good morning, Randy.
Good morning, Aki. Good morning, Houston. Good morning, Rebecca. Good morning, Wyatt. And good morning to our little girl. Thank you for that song.
This is Mission Control Houston. The camera's on board Atlantis inside the payload bay being tilted up. You can see Africa there is...
Houston Airlock, step 13, verifying PSA out, utility outlet power loading.
Stand by a sec, Butch.
Houston Atlantis on the big loop. Go ahead. Dan, just wanted to take this opportunity to report some good news. At 11:04 last night, Abigail Mayo Resnick joined the NASA family, and Mama and Baby are doing very well. Very thankful that for everyone there at Mission Control and everywhere else throughout NASA that's been so supportive and especially so helpful in the last couple of days with everything that's been going on, you know. And if thank you to Mike Serafin and all the team there in Mission Control for being so hospitable to Wyatt yesterday, and to Brian Smith and the ISS side for all their support and for enduring untold questions during the news conferences.
Yeah, Randy, thank you very much for those words, and thanks for recognizing the significant accomplishments on Earth that happened while you guys were working hard on your challenging mission in orbit. On behalf of the Planet Earth ground team, please accept our heartfelt congratulations.
And Houston Atlantis on the big loop.
Go ahead.
just wanted to take this opportunity to report some good news. At 11:04 last night, Abigail Mayo-Resnick joined the NASA family, and Mama and Baby are doing very well. Very thankful that for everyone there at Mission Control and everywhere else throughout NASA that's been so supportive and especially so helpful in the last couple of days with everything that's been going on. And if thank you to Mike Serafin and all the team there in Mission Control for being so hospitable to Wyatt yesterday, and Brian Smith and the ISS side for all their support and for enduring untold questions during the news conferences.
Randy, thank you very much for those words, and thanks for recognizing the significant accomplishments on Earth that happened while you guys were working hard on your challenging mission in orbit. On behalf of the Planet Earth ground team, please accept our heartfelt congratulations.
Thanks very much, Dan. Is Smith Johnson in the house today?
No, sir. We believe him to be getting some hard-earned rest now.
All right. Well, he'll have something for you all later in the day when he comes in.
Outstanding. We'll be looking forward to that.
Birth of his first daughter, and he's still on board the space shuttle Atlantis. Resnick, who is currently on his first space flight, was given the news of baby Abigail by Mission Control while he and his crew circled the Earth. It's only the second time an astronaut has become a father while in space. Mr. Resnick is due to return to Earth on Friday after an 11-day mission.
This is Mission Control Houston. Again, this is some video that was downlinked by the crew of celebrations on board the International Space Station as Randy Resnick passed out cigars following the birth of his new daughter, Abigail May. Again, she was born at 11:04 p.m. Central Time on November the 21st, weighing in at 6 pounds, 13 ounces, 20 inches in length. Just before the crew began its sleep shift today, Randy Resnick had an opportunity to do a private family conference, talking with his family on the ground about the joyous event. Resnick also displaying a specially prepared pink onesie with the STS-129 crew patch emblazoned. And wearing an It's a Girl t-shirt. Congratulations for the new father all around from the other 11 humans on orbit right now.
So, comrade, how does it feel to be a proud new father of a baby girl?
Pretty unbelievable, Bobby. It's pretty thankful that, you know, everything went well on Earth and that everything's gone so well up here. And you know, in span of one day, I got to do an EVA for the first time and just amazed and awed at what I was able to see. But, you know, like I said during the EVA, I don't think, other than seeing my wife for the first time, that I've ever seen more beautiful than being outside. But I think once I get to see the pictures today of our new daughter, EVA is going to have to take a third place.
Very well stated, sir. Very well stated. And congratulations from all of us.
Thanks.
All right. Of course, we got to get the celebratory fist bump. All right.
Hey, Rebecca, congratulations from Bobby. And also, looks like we got Leland in the house here.
Way to go, Rebecca. You endured some serious, I guess, labor pains and things, but hey, it was all worth it for that beautiful baby girl. And we're up here to congratulate you and Comrade for a beautiful family.
All right. Yep, yep, and we will.
We're introducing a new segment today on Flight Day Highlights. We're calling it the Hot Corner with Scorch. Scorch, we got a couple questions for you today. First, how was the launch?
Hey, if it's a hot corner with me, shouldn't it be you on the hot seat? No, the launch was incredible, Mike. The vehicle performed perfectly. The crew performed perfectly. We had just an incredible experience on the way up. Eight and a half minutes, we're at Miko and already in space, suborbital trajectory. Can't say enough about how good it was with the vehicle and the control team. Thumbs up.
What'd you think about your rendezvous?
That might be a trick question. I thought the rendezvous went great, and everyone on the crew really helped make it go extremely well. We back each other up. We work as a team. The ground supported us all the way through. The station was amazing. It starts off as a little speck. We could pick it up very early in the day, and it just grows and grows and grows. Huge solar arrays when we're in the sun. Just makes it stand out against that background of space just remarkably well.
What are your impressions of the mission so far?
I don't know how it could be going any better. We got an incredible crew, not only on the shuttle side, but on the station side. And with everything that's going on so far, there hasn't been any major hiccups. We're really enjoying it and think it's going incredible.
And why do they call it the hot corner?
I think it's because of all the intense light and all your grilling questions. But thanks, Mike. It was a pleasure doing it.
Got a red light?
Hello, we're in the Soyuz. Jeff Williams behind the camera. We're aft of the service module on the very back end of the station. We're gonna transit all the way through to the shuttle, show you everything from one end to the other. Here we go. This is the bay O, the top of the Soyuz. Now we're into the service module. The very aft end of the Russian segment. See a lot of the gear, the computers, cameras on the walls. We'll continue forward now. Our next stop will be the first juncture in the Russian segment, where we'll look down first into the docking compartment, and you see a progress cargo transfer there at the bottom. If you look up now, you'll see the brand new Russian segment, the MRM2, the science module. Got a little bit of gear packed in it for the transit uphill, and they're starting to put it into work now. We're going to turn around. Jeff's taking the lead, and we're in the FGB. A lot of cargo stored in the FGB. A lot of stuff. There's food, storage, some scientific material, stuff behind the walls, of course, stuff on the floor here. Little mirror here, place where you can clean up, take a bath, and now we're in the next juncture where we look down into the other Soyuz that is attached. At the very juncture between the FGB and Node 1. Jeff's backing up now into Node 1 through some more storage area in this PMA-1, this mating adapter. And now we open up into Node 1. You can see Roman here. He's working on A-Red.
Hey, this is me.
And we'll turn around the other way. You can see Randy, Bobby, and Mike. Yeah. Working, doing some EMU reconfig. Continuing into the lab. Say hello. Hi, Frank.
Hello, everybody.
Sir Commander. ISS Commander.
Hello.
Frank DeWin, robotics workstations. Cephas, basically a bicycle. Station potty.
Okay, Swanee, I'm with you on page two, right? And
coming on through
as well.
Well, there's Bob first in the flesh. Sitting here in node two.
Bobby's column.
From Bobby's column.
Coming up node two, of course, a connection from various parts of the station. We'll look this way into Columbus. You can see the station spacewalking suits, the EMUs are stashed there on the ceiling, some more storage on the floor. Japanese experimental module, the gem, with another sleep station on the floor, other things stored here and there. A working laboratory. Come on, we're into the shuttle now, through the primary mating adapter. Making the 90 degree turn. Now we're on the mid deck. There's our commander, Charlie Holbaugh.
Doing one.
Scorch. And now we're continuing up to the flight deck. See the flight deck? Commander seat, pilot seat. We got a couple of seats removed here in the back that we'll have for entry. And then we'll look out the overhead window at station. We certainly hope you've enjoyed your tour from Soyuz to shuttle. Thanks for all the great work everybody's doing on the ground supporting us. Thank you.
It was workout time. As yours truly, Butch on the A-Rad, then a little squat. And there's our illustrious Commander Scorch, pumping about 400 pounds on the bench press. Or maybe it was 40, I can't remember. This is meal time. The EVA guys are doing a little review for their EVA tomorrow. And then we got everybody together in the Node 1 for our dinner. Cuisine. We do want to say thank you to all our food preparation folks. They really do have some good chow up here. It's tasty and it's good for us as well. We don't think we showed you our ELCs, Express Logistics Carriers we brought up, so we thought we'd show you a shot of them here. Here's ELC 2 on the top side of the starboard truss, and here's ELC 1 on the nadir or bottom side of the port truss. Megan, that's all we have for you today. Hope you enjoyed it.
Well, Butch, that was just incredible. We appreciate all the effort that you guys are putting into all the footage that you're sending down. It really is a treat for everyone here on the ground. We particularly enjoyed your end-to-end tour. For those of us that have never been on the space station, that was really special.
ISS Houston on air to ground two. Welcome to another gorgeous day in space, and a special good morning to Mike.
Thanks, Houston. Thanks, Janice. And I especially want to thank my good friend Larry Whitehair, who wrote and recorded that song Space Rise for the STS-129 crew. Makes a fantastic mission that much more special, and we appreciate it. Thanks very much, Larry.
This is Mission Control Houston. As you can see inside the Quest airlock, Bobby Satcher being moved into the crew airlock portion of this part of the station. He's being helped along by Commander Charlie Hobaugh and Nicole Stott and Barry Wilmore. And the team in Houston now confirming that the depressurization of that part of Quest is now in work.
When the crew lock gets to 6.0, you can expect an alert tone.
It's in station on 2 for Robo.
There you see STS-129 Commander Charlie Hobaugh there in the back, Leland Melvin there in the front. They're at the robotics workstation. The stationed robotic arm will be put into work today, helping install this high-pressurized gas tank.
A little better with the robotics ops.
As you can see, Atlantis's payload bay fairly empty now. The ELC-1 and ELC-2 are out on the respective ends of the station on the truss structure.
Looks good.
And now that Missy 7 has been retrieved, that pretty much empties out the payload bay of the shuttle. As you can see, this is the second of these Missy experiment suitcases. As you can tell, they really do look like small briefcases or suitcases. The way that they operate is they're basically just opened up and spread open and exposed to space for several months at a time. And then whenever the astronauts go out there to retrieve them, they're simply closed back up and latched together and stored away. This is a look at Bobby Satcher's helmet cam. He is on his way outside the International Space Station over to ELC-2. The Express Logistics Carrier number 2. This is where this high pressurized gas tank or this oxygen tank is located. Once Randy Bresnik has finished up bundling together the Missy 7 experiment, the two different briefcases that are part of that, he will meet him out at this location. Bobby Satcher there at the top left part of your screen. That large white object, that is the high-pressurized gas tank that he and Randy Bresnik will be focused on for the first half of today's spacewalk. You're getting a good view of just exactly how big this gas tank is. It weighs more than 1,200 pounds. The entire outside cover is 5 feet by 6.2 feet by 4.5 feet. The actual tank on the inside is about 3 feet in diameter.
Bay 15, Bobby. How do you like that BRT on the right, comrade? It's not bad at all. Not able to handle the mass quite as well as we hoped.
You can see them working there, one on top of the truss, one down below. If you look at the top of the truss, you can see Randy Bresnik with these two Missy 7 suitcases attached to him as he continues to move toward ELC-2, which you see there, and Bobby Satcher down below it.
That is Houston, big loop for you good.
All right, pitching up towards the end effector. 3, 2, 1, mark. Nice and slow. All right, stop motion.
Bravo.
All right, that's easy enough to control. Let's rotate it back. Start motion.
Satcher and Bresnik now beginning the delicate process of moving this 1,200-pound oxygen tank around to get it positioned to be attached to the station's robotic arm. The robotic arm will then be used to move it over to Quest.
Ready? Ready. All right. Start in motion. Nice and slow. All right. My handle there. All right, stand by, stop motion.
Stop.
All right, Bobby, you ready for the grapple?
I am ready.
Guys ready, we're ready, we're gonna start coming in.
All right, get in.
Big, isn't it?
Here shortly, Leland Melvin, the lead robotics officer for this mission, is going to use the station's robotic arm to inch closer to this gas tank and snatch it from Satcher and Bresnik, who will then meet back up with it over at the Quest airlock and begin the process of installing it.
Okay, guys, we hear you're clear. We're going to make some changes to our command frames, and then we'll be ready to back off.
Sounds great.
Clear to maneuver.
Okay, Bobby, you're going to do a glove check.
Okay, give me a few seconds, and we'll put that in the works.
This is a view from Randy Bresnik's helmet cam. You can see his reflection there. The part that he's working on is basically the carrier plate for this Missy 7 experiment. This is where it will be mounted until a future flight when it will be retrieved and brought back home.
Okay, Bobby, thanks for that call, and glove check when you get a chance.
Got it. Coming shortly.
As you can see, the station's robotic arm being used to move this giant high-pressure gas tank. This is the oxygen tank that Satcher and Bresnik released just a few minutes ago from that large cargo pallet you see at the bottom right corner of your screen. It will be moved over to the Quest airlock where Satcher and Bresnik will meet up with it once again and begin to install it. As we mentioned earlier, they're going to be keeping a close eye on the installation of this. There's some fairly tight clearances around this area. There's an antenna there that they don't anticipate having to remove. But if they feel like it's going to get in the way of the installation of this gas tank, or if there's going to be some damage done to the antenna, they will remove it once they get over there.
Hey guys, snares are open. We're backing off the grapple fixture.
Sounds good.
All right, we see it backing away.
And there goes the station's arm, currently backing away from the high pressurized gas tank.
Very nice work, guys. Perfection on both ends. Hi, Bobby.
It's work in this installation is now over.
Come on down. That's our guys, folks.
Okay, you guys have to go to soft dock there. both poop tins, Randy. Oh, I see you're working on the second one.
Edit both. Going for wire ties. Remove my
lip. Copy that. Okay, comrade, the MMOD shields are bundled. Obviously, you're going to ret to the long T tool. Release the long T tool, ret from the crew lock bag. Disengage the short T tool.
Did work.
Today's spacewalk by Randy Bresnik, a new father, and Bobby Satcher entering the home phase as we're just about to cross over into the four-hour mark.
Looking for the pre-existing MLI so you can adjust that to fully uncover the connector. Look under your finger there on that, and the cable itself has a little, right about where your left thumb was. It's a little placard. It might not be facing you, though. You might have to move the cable around a little bit to read that.
Oh, I got you.
Not there?
Not there. In a locked position with a good tug test.
Okay, you can retrieve your ret.
This view of Bobby Satcher from the Payload Bay cameras on the Shuttle Atlantis, looking down as he works at the mobile transporter system with the installation of several different insulation covers on the outside of camera ports for the latching end effector on the base side of the space station's robotic arm, as well as on the mobile base system transporter rail system itself.
We're double checking that, Mike, too. And did you get the crew life bag, the adjustables? We look at it again, and maybe, again, we're sorry about this, but we're taking our best guesses here. It might have been an adjustable.
Okay, is the adjustable, is it adjustable still on the crew life bag, Bobby?
Yeah, it is.
Okay.
Thanks, Mike. We're still checking.
Spacewalkers commenting on the beauty of New Zealand as they pass 220 statute miles almost directly overhead of Christchurch.
Yes, sir. Thermal cover's closed.
Hey, check the little thermal the little Velcro tab there. I'm good. Yourself?
I'm good, thank you.
It's been a very busy day.
That's awesome, Mike. Well, we'll head over to the airlock and see what's happening over there.
Roadblock to get to the airlock.
Here we are at the airlock. They're actually down at 10.2 PSI. It's a phase they go through to get them prepped for EVA. Not a very good shot here, but what you can see is Nicole and Butch are helping Randy and Bobby get into the suits. It's all a phase to purge the nitrogen out of their system before going to the lower pressure outside. They're at about 4.2 PSI. In the suit in 100% oxygen environment. It's a critical phase of prep. They actually spent a whole night at a lower pressure repressurized, came outside just to get a bite to eat and get ready, go back inside, and now it's suit up time. Okay, here we are in the U.S. lab. We got the Station Increment Commander, Frank DeVin, and good old Leland Melvin, one of our favorites here, and we're doing some transfer prep. Let us know what you're doing.
Well, we have actually the distillation assembly, which is part of our urine and water pressing unit, which has unfortunately failed, and we are preparing this unit to return to the ground so it can be, first of all, looked at what has failed, and that unit to return to the ground so it can procedure writers do, because we get generically trained on what we do in the systems, but not for every single task. So finally, after 9 months, the first time that I look to this box and that I disconnect it and will remove it. It's great, the confidence that the people are showing in us.
Who's the man, Leland?
Frank's the man.
It's the confidence that the people are showing in us.
Who's the man, Leland?
Frank's the man.
He's watching the tank move on the end of the arm.
In English, we call those displays, but Mr. Barry Eugene Butch Wilmore calls them displays. Mr. Barry Eugene Butch Wilmore calls them displays.
It's a pretty cool Japanese experiment they're doing with almost live worms. It's basically what they are, sea worms.
Here we are in the service module with the increment crew all having lunch while the EVA is going on. Expedition, yeah, we know what it's all about. Maxime, what's up?
Hey, y'all, what's up?
Hanging in the hood, his
yeah.
Homies.
It's my homies.
So how was the lunch?
Delish.
What'd you have?
Spaghetti and mushrooms.
Always. What do we have?
I have vermicelli and...
Vermicelli.
Beef with vegetables.
What is that? Sounds like a bacteria or something.
It's basically spaghetti without sauce.
Cool.
I
you guys are doing awesome.
Peppers.
This is the best expedition crew I've ever flown with this mission.
Listen. You're going to tell this the same.
This is my words.
You've got to be very, very quiet. Mike's a very busy man. He's right in the middle of IV for EVA 3. Hey, Mike, do you have a minute?
Sure, Scorch.
Tell me how it's going.
It's going well. We're just about to get this tank installed. We got the Missy's installed already, and, you know, IV, it's the most stressful job in the EVA world.
Absolutely. You're a one-arm paper hanger. Show us your tools, Mike, real quick.
I got WVS cameras over here, keeping tapes running in there. I got counters for sunrise, sunset, the tape counters. I got a PET clock going here. We're right at 2 hours and 15 minutes on the EVA right now. And,
it's the best thing about being in the orbiters. You got these big old windows you can see them out of, right?
Yeah, that's the best thing. Is the best thing to be able to see is just looking out the windows. We've got nice cameras all around, but best views out the window.
Back to work, Mike. Me too. Here we are with Barry Eugene Butch Wilmore. Butch, what are we up to right now?
We are repressing the crew lock. About to bring the boys in after their 5.5 hour EVA.
Was there anyone we forgot to thank for this EVA?
Actually, the folks that made the joint oil lock here. I think that you couldn't do it without the folks. That
how about the people that brought it up?
Them too. That would be you.
That'd be me, Barry Eugene, Butch Wilmore. Yes. And Nicole.
Howdy doody.
And we already have Randy getting some of his equipment off right now. He's out of the airlock. Bobby's still waiting on the other end. You see his feet. You go head to foot, foot to head as they come in. All right, here we are just coming in from the EVA, part of our highlights for the day. Tell us what in the world you guys were doing outside for over 5 hours.
Well, we started out moving some gear, Bobby did, and then went over to this payload bay, grabbed the Missy 7 experiment. Got a tank, put that in on the so the station has more O2. Then we went out and did some jumpers. We did some APFR, some get-aheads for other flights. And other than that, we enjoyed the phenomenal view that we got to see.
Yeah, I think the biggest things were the tank and the missies. The missies, which were the material science experiments that Comrade put up on ELC-2, which looks great, by the way. ELCs look great.
Okay, and we were just goofing around inside where you guys were outside. We had a lot of transfer going on. Good job, guys.
Thank you.
Leland, doing transfer. Is all this stuff going to fit?
I don't know. I'm trying to make it work, but this is one of the last few bags for today until flight day 9, transfer tomorrow. And hey, Stan, I think we got most of it done.
Keep up the good work.
Hey, you too, Stuart. Great command,
man. And that's the day of today. Hope you enjoy it.
Max is trying to take
it. Hey, as we get prepared for Thanksgiving coming up, we got to think about all this. Look at all this food we got. We got all kinds of stuff.
Thanksgiving, because we're having a feast here.
Feasting around. Everybody say hi.
Hello.
Hello.
Cool.
Delicious. Yummy.
This is yummy. Delicious, yummy. Hey. Say something, Mike.
Good food.
Zwei Astronauten der US-Raumfähre Atlantis absolvieren einen weiteren Außeneinsatz an der Raumstation ISS. Sie sollen einen Sauerstofftank umsetzen und ein Experiment außerhalb der Raumstation vorbereiten. Es ist der letzte Außeneinsatz der 11-tägigen Mission. Übermorgen soll die Atlantis den Rückweg zur Erde antreten.
In der US-Raumfähre Atlantis haben ihre Montagearbeiten an der internationalen Raumstation ISS abgeschlossen. Sie installierten einen Sauerstofftank und wissenschaftliche Geräte. Morgen soll die Atlantis den Rückweg zur Erde antreten. An Bord der Raumstation feierte Astronaut Kresnik die Geburt seiner Tochter. Er gab der Mannschaft eine Runde Zigarren aus, die aber nicht geraucht werden durften.
Die Tagesschau meldet sich wieder um 8.30 Uhr.
Houston on Air to Ground 2, a rousing wake-up song this morning. You can probably guess who that was for.
We've got two guesses.
You win, Scorch.
I tell you what, I got everybody floating at attention, heels locked, and yelling Simple Sigh. A few grunts here and there. Other than that, we're good to go.
Tradition with every shuttle crew or shuttle arrival and departure, a farewell ceremony, the crew gathering in preparation for that farewell ceremony, and also the hatch closure and preparations for Atlantis's departure.
All right, now if you guys can all go back a little bit, and then we'll take transfer item 914.
Wow.
Sit on the ground.
See you.
See you.
Bob.
Mike will do either.
Yeah. Be gentle.
All right, ready?
Here we go.
Thank you.
Bye.
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 As you know, Megan, we got to do a couple of checks, and finally we get to actually closing the hatch.
Can you imagine the days of...
Gemeinschaftsflug haben sich die 12 Besatzungsmitglieder der Internationalen Raumstation ISS und der US-Raumfähre Atlantis voneinander verabschiedet. Die Atlantis soll heute mit 7 Astronauten an Bord von der ISS ablegen und am Freitag im US-Weltraumzentrum Cape Canaveral landen. Dort war die Raumfähre vor 9 Tagen gestartet.
Good morning, Atlantis, and special good morning for you, Butch.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Thank you very much, Aki. It's a great way to wake up.
Well, it's our pleasure.
Nice to be here. Nice to be the newest crew member of STS-129.
And, you know, in order to break her in, one of the things that we had to do was have her do the flight day highlights, since we've all had our own crack at it. My first one was, of course, on docking day. So this is undocking day for us, flight day 10. And Nicole was actually here on the station for 3 months.
Right?
So I know it's a very special time for you, because it was a wonderful experience, obviously, that you had on the station. So this one is going to be, I guess, your way of saying goodbye, another way of saying goodbye.
Yeah, it's nice. We're here on the mid-deck of Atlantis, and it's really cool to be on the space shuttle again. Of course, it's a little sad for me to be leaving the space station behind, but as Bobby said, it was an amazing experience, and I'm looking forward to getting back home to my family and
yeah,
a little bit of sunshine,
ups,
maybe.
Big ups, Ned,
yeah.
Right? Good to see the kiddo.
Yeah, and... maybe some pizza, and so
what's your favorite
here's a
pizza
bonus.
Place?
No, I don't know. There's a couple in Houston that we like, but
yeah.
I'm a fan of the traditional New York style
I got you.
Slices.
All right, so flight day highlights, day 10.
What's up, Brother Bobby?
All right.
Let's get home. You ready to go home?
I'm ready, man. You ready?
Let's go, man.
I'll get you drivers. I'll be back here for the drivers.
Okay, that's cool.
Scissors for a
man who said he got a little bit of work.
Yeah.
So, Mike, that's a very nice matching hat and shirt you got here.
You like my ensemble today?
I do.
This is the STS-129 Mike Forman look, you know, signature collection.
You need a work light on this.
Yeah.
Here, hold on. Let's
hide
get
the shadows.
Let's get at least on
flash.
These are shirts right here.
All
right.
Semper Fi! Whatever.
You got the Marine thing going.
Hey, we're civilians, baby.
Civilians.
Where's the civilian love?
All right, Butch, get wasn't ready asking. To undock.
Making yes.
Undocking. That's it. Oh, yeah. That would be me.
I think that's
on the controls, mostly down, just going to want to fly up. Push it down. We'll get up 400 feet, and we'll start going all the way around the station.
Yeah,
hopefully, we make it a little round. So
how do you get to do that fly around?
Well, I tell you what, it's going to be teamwork. These guys are going to help me out. They're going to shoot and tell
can
us
you
the range.
Can you demonstrate to us what the fly around is?
Yeah, the fly around is when we go. Yeah. We
We're now 1 minute and 30 seconds away from the undocking of Atlantis from the station. The team here in Houston reporting that pressurized mating adapter number 2, which is what forms the connection between the station and the shuttle, is under the process of setting up the hooks to release the orbiter.
TCS is good.
Okay. Pedals are clear. I got LBLH.
Okay, your first pulse is at 16 on my clock. What do you got?
It's in the way.
Is that your second out?
No, I haven't done an out yet.
Oh, okay. That was just attitude fire.
Yeah.
Yeah, those are all attitude fire. Physical set plus a minute,
can you
get burned.
Can you, can we focus the camera or no?
What'd you say?
Now we have the,
set plus 1 minute. 50 seconds is what I got, Bud.
Sounds good.
And you got burn in a minute. Out at 10 second intervals.
Yep.
United States Space Shuttle Atlantis and
there's
International
burn.
Space Station crew member Nicole Studd departing.
Give me some opening.
The underground, yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna give an out. I have to tell me.
TCS is good. 0.16 showing on the raw right now,
yep.
Butch.
That's all I expected. It's over that before. I'm gonna give it a little beep.
With a 0.18, your opening rate is good, Butch.
I like it.
Which were 250 for 320.
Yep.
Score ships 123, pitch negative 5.5, and roll.
How about a range?
0.15. Range 27.
Okay.
To the group.
That's it.
Okay. Shoot for 0.2, a little boring. Gonna hurt you.
Yeah, I'm gonna go to 0.24 is what I'm hoping for.
Okay, that's
down.
Okay, I agree.
That was a down. I'll give it out in 5 seconds.
It's your out.
There it is.
This is 5.5. Yaw 1.3. Roll 1.1.
Target added.
Can you drive that thing?
All right, we're at greater than 50 feet. Thank you. Get the KU two part back there.
Got it. Give
it to me. I think the first step is probably in Spectator 3.
Here we go.
Thanks, buddy.
This view from Atlantis's payload bay cameras as
the shuttle
continues to drift away.
Block 6 Alpha going 8 Alpha, if you agree.
Concur.
Atlantis now at 65 feet away from the International Space Station and increasing. At the very top of the screen, you can see the Soyuz TMA-15. As we mentioned, that will serve as the ride home for Frank DeWenna, Bob Thirsk, and Roman Romanenko coming up on November 30th. That is Central Time. They will be landing on December 1st, shortly after midnight Central Time. That landing time will occur at 1:16 a.m. Central Time. Our coverage here on NASA television will begin at 6:30 p.m. the evening before. We'll have several different broadcasts that night of the farewells, the undocking, and the landing of DeWenna, Thirsk, and Romanenko. As Atlantis is 250 feet away from it, you can clearly see pressurized mating adapter number 2 there. That is the former home of Atlantis for almost the past week. On the left is Columbus. On the right is the Kibo Laboratory with its robotic arm there on the right. At the very bottom in the foreground, you can see the Soyuz TMA-15 that will soon serve as Frank DeWenna's and Bob Thirsk and Roman Romanenko's ride home. Beginning on November 30th, they will land in Kazakhstan on December 1st. Back behind it is the Progress resupply cargo craft. And what is not in this field of view, but you will see once STS-129 pilot Barry Wilmore begins the fly around, is the Soyuz TMA-16, which is what brought up Jeff Williams and Max Sarayev. STS-129 pilot Barry Wilmore at the controls of Atlantis, taking the shuttle up and over the U.S. segment as he completes this fly around of the station complex. He will steer Atlantis over the truss structure and then back around the Russian segment and then down below it.
Atlantis, if you would like to do a item 16 on spec 33 to do a Kovar Reinet, we think that'll help.
Okay, Kovar Reinet will do it.
Now getting live video from the station as Atlantis continues its fly around. This is being taken from one of the truss cameras. The very empty payload bay of the shuttle, as Atlantis has delivered all of its cargo. It's bringing home almost a ton of supplies on the mid-deck. And it's also bringing home Nicole Stott as she begins the final leg of her journey back to Earth after spending 87 days aboard the station as a member of Expedition 20 and 21. Atlantis now 468 feet away from the station. It has completed about 45 degrees of this 360-degree tour of the complex. It is continuing to open up the distance. It will go out to about 600 to 700 feet away as it completes this revolution. Atlantis now 500 feet away from the station under the command of STS pilot Barry Wilmore as he continues to steer the shuttle in a circle around the entire station complex. The nose of the shuttle just beginning to reveal itself on the other side of the station's robotic arm. Atlantis now 532 feet away from the complex.
And Houston Station on Space to Ground 2 for video. I'll keep tracking the lab camera. You're free to grab the other cameras to go to a predictable view when they come around again.
Okay, Jeff, thanks for the info. We copy and we'll put it in work.
Houston Station on two step stick of six of the PMA to decrease procedure is complete.
We copy, Frank, and you are go for step seven of the procedure.
Copy, go for step seven.
Near that white area you see there is the city of Sarajevo. As Atlantis and the station continue their pass, they are currently at an altitude of 212 miles above the surface of the Earth. Atlantis is continuing to circle the entire station. It is beginning the final portion of this fly around. It is coming back up toward the U.S. segment once it reaches the point that it departed from, close to pressurized mating adapter number 2. It will begin to fire its engines and begin the process of leaving the station's area.
Planet Houston for timeline and the dump and power down.
So this is
this is
chance to look over?
You got 1735,
right? Flickers on TCS had changed
on the northern coastline of South America will be beautiful.
Can you see the monitor?
Your yeah, I'm looking at it.
Your TCS5, which
I still like where I'm at, right on the trails.
Hey, you still had a quick cross in our legs now.
Almost 500 feet now.
Yep.
TCS is a reflective.
We'll give an in.
Three.
I agree.
Yeah, you're going to start feathering some in. Yeah, we're our bar effect's going to start pulling you out even more, right. So just keep it low.
Buddies in the
incense,
looking at us.
So this is,
I can't
this is Aruba?
Is that Aruba?
No, Falklands.
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 Is it
right.
Falklands. Falklands.
We're going to do it.
Wait, can you reach up 400 down the wall?
400 would be madness.
Ian.
Still get me airlock. I'm gonna go for the back of the nose.
That might
one.
Alright. 0.2, 611 Butch on the ring. I'd get to about 650 before you start thinking of an end.
Right.
625 to 626 on the range.
Yeah, 0.25.
Still shooting airlock?
What's to the front, the engine of the node.
Okay. Okay.
That's kind of more.
Yeah, that's better. More normal for you. 626. Yeah. Your range held constant between those two last ones.
Yep.
Did you just do an in?
I'm about to now.
Okay. A or B?
That's an A.
That's an A. Okay. Hold what you got.
That's
see it.
See
your eyes. That one went 655.
116.
What's your radar been showing you, buddy?
Track the whole time.
No, I mean range.
Oh. Yeah.
Throw that into your scan.
Yeah, I haven't done it.
It's there. It's raw. Just showing. Just showing you where the point went over.
Yeah.
Just can't get it.
Is that it for now, Bush?
That's it for me.
660. So 61.
That's a bad raw.
On the big loop, station is maneuvering for our pump. The new attitude is LVLH pitch yaw roll -1.7, -5.0.
Yeah. I got it. It's pushing down. Okay, copy. It's for the
right, new aim point, Butch.
Okay.
Crew on board making very good progress with today's inspection of the thermal protection system. They have wrapped up the starboard wing survey, the right wing of the shuttle. They will next move out toward the nose cap or the very front portion of the shuttle to take a look at the reinforced carbon-carbon that comprises that part of the orbiter. They are still running about 30 minutes ahead of schedule, but the team here in Houston will continue to monitor their progress as they work toward completing this survey.
on the flight deck with the crew of STS-129 on the Space Shuttle Atlantis. Yesterday, we departed from the International Space Station and leaving behind five of our international crew members. But together, as we orbit the Earth every 90 minutes, we would like to wish you a very happy Thanksgiving.
Happy Thanksgiving.
Whether your holiday meal is floating out in front of you or resting firmly on your table, from our family to yours, NASA wishes you a very happy Thanksgiving.
Fly me to the moon. Let me play among the stars. Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, hold my hand. In other words, baby, kiss me.
Good morning, Atlantis, and special good morning for MS-5.
Good morning, Houston, Aki, and happy Thanksgiving. That was a really nice song to wake up to here on our final full day on orbit. Special thanks to my husband and son for sending that. I love them, too, and look forward to seeing them real soon. Thanks again.
Space Shuttle Atlantis is in position for this upcoming orbital maneuvering system burn. That involves having the shuttle with its tail end pointed away from the Earth so that the plume can point up for this experiment, which is the SITE, or Shuttle Exhaust Ion Turbulence Experiment, that again uses satellites to observe the effect that firings of the shuttle's orbital maneuvering system has on the ionosphere, particularly its density and electric field disturbances.
And Atlantis, we are on board with you. Nice to see you on the flight deck.
Mission Specialist Randy Bresnik here in the foreground and behind Tim Pilot Barry Wilmore inside the shuttle's flight deck, getting ready to start the flight control system checkout in about 23 minutes from now. This view coming from cameras in the Space Shuttle Atlantis' cargo bay, looking down at some thunderstorms going on above Indonesia. The crew just passing over Indonesia on a southeasterly course that's going to take them over the coast of Australia in the next few minutes.
You're ready for the event, Herbie.
We got ABC, this is Houston. Please call Atlantis for a voice check.
Atlantis, this is ABC. How do you hear me?
Loud and clear.
Good morning to the crew of Atlantis. You're live on ABC Radio nationwide. Let's start with you, Butch. You got to take Atlantis for a spin around the space station yesterday. How did that orbit handle?
It was actually fantastic. And it wasn't just me. It was the entire crew working together. Randy was working the HHL, the laser ranger. Leland was working a display we have where I can see a digital printout of the process, or the trajectory of where we're headed and where we've been. So actually, it was great to be on the controls, but it was certainly a team effort for all of us.
George, you're commanding the second-to-last flight of Atlantis, very historic mission. Tell me how your team on orbit on the ground and your spaceship have worked together during this flight.
It was absolutely a team effort, not only just our crew and the ground, but the station crew, which we really never get a chance to train with, see, or interact with much pre-flight. We arrive on orbit, greet them. They're like long-lost brothers and sister, and we get right to work, and it was seamless. It was like we'd always work together and play together, too. We made great friends while we were up there, and we got a lot accomplished. It was a fantastic mission.
And Randy, before you launched, you told us how blessed you and your family were on this Thanksgiving Day. What are you giving thanks for? And a second question, is your daughter as beautiful as your mom?
To answer the first question, fortunately, she is just as beautiful as her mother, and I always said if our daughter got her looks and her brains, we'd be okay, so I'm thankful for that. But, you know, just the timing of it all, you know, God had the timing down pat. You know, we were fortunate enough to get an EVA out, find out that, you know, the baby was delivered safely, and she's healthy, Rebecca's, you know, doing well, and then we got to go out the door for another EVA. I mean, just the most amazing 3 days of my life so far, and I just look forward to getting home tomorrow and seeing her for the first time in person. And so I'm thankful for that, and I'm also thankful for, you know, this crew, for, you know, all the support and love I've gotten from them during this whole process.
Nicole, before you launched, you told us you were bringing up watercolors to space. How did that work, and what images did you most want to capture with your paints?
Well, it was quite a while before I was able to actually do anything, and I ended up painting actually only one picture, and it was of a Bahama reef, and I found with all of the Earth observation photography I was doing, I really enjoyed most photographing coastlines and islands and atolls and just the beautiful water around the world, and the Bahamas stands out as one of the most impressive places on the planet, and so that's what I chose to paint in the time that I had. And I've left the art supplies on board for anybody else in the future who wants to try it out, and I hope that somebody does. It was really fun.
And for Bobby and Leland, we watch you toss a football around with Butch and Scorch all week. There's seven of you. Football is a traditional Thanksgiving event. How do you find your game in space?
Well, our game is a little, we have to adjust a little bit for our game because you can't, you know, obviously run down the field, but you have to find a place where you can push off and make sure that you don't get hit too hard by someone like Butch behind me. He kind of stole me. He didn't tell me he was coming, but we had a great time, and it was a lot of fun.
Mike Foreman, this was your last spatial spacewalk. What were your thoughts when you finished that last spacewalk up there?
Well, I was just really proud of our team. You know, we have a couple of folks up here that get to go outside, but we have literally hundreds of people on the ground that are trained and helped us to get ready for those spacewalks. And I was just really, you know, had a sense of pride of, you know, how we had performed for them down there, and just excited that we had completed all of our tasks, and I think did fairly well.
Atlantis, happy Thanksgiving, Godspeed. See you on the ground tomorrow.
Atlantis, this is WTVT in Tampa. Can you hear me?
We can hear you loud and clear.
Hey, Nicole, it's Ruffel. We'll get started here and do this in just a second, okay?
Hi, Russell. Nice to hear your voice again.
You're my hero. We'll get into it in a second. Hang on. We're about to do this. All right. We have watched the goings-on at the International Space Station very closely these last few months. That's because one of our own has been there. Nicole Stott calls Clearwater her hometown. She joins us from Atlantis along with the rest of the crew. Nicole, you're headed home. You excited about getting here?
Yeah, I'm very excited. You know, it was mixed feelings, actually. I was really sad to leave the station and my crewmates there, but I have a new bunch here that are really, really great, and I'm getting to go home and see my family, so yeah, I'm really excited.
I have to tell you, I've been following you on Twitter. I've been following your blog and a couple of things you said. Let's see, woohoo about the launch that got you up there. You've talked about spacewalking, and you've talked about looking back at the Earth. Talk to me about that, looking back at the Earth, what that was like.
Well, it's just incredible. It really is indescribable. I was always impressed by the photographs I would see from the other astronauts that had flown before me, and you know, that was incredibly beautiful, but you just are not prepared for it the first time you see it. And for me, that was out of the windows of Discovery, and the black of space, it's blacker than anything I've seen before, and it's just highlighted by this beautiful, glowing, colorful planet. And I just wasn't ready for it. And it was something that stayed with me for the entire time on station. Every time I would look out the window, I would be impressed again by just how wonderful it is. And then fortunately got the bug for taking pictures of it. And I hope that I've captured in some way what I've seen, but I honestly doubt it. And I'm trying to look out the window as much as possible here from Atlantis, and it just continues to impress. So thanks for the question.
Well, let me ask you this too, because you said, and you also put on your Twitter page today, watching in awe as we fly around and away from my home for the last 3 months. What a spectacular spacecraft. Talk to me about the space station.
Well, it is spectacular, and it's both inside and out. The same as like as looking at the planet when we approached in Discovery, when I arrived at the space station. It's just something you can't be ready for. It's, you know, beautiful is not a word that can describe it. It glows, it shines, it gets bigger and bigger as you get closer to it, of course, and it just really kind of overwhelms you. There's something about getting to space that's kind of it's a sensory overload. There's things you're just not prepared for. And then you get inside, and again, you're floating around, and you're inside this what is now a huge volume of space to move around with all of the modules up there. And it's just neat that all of a sudden, after a short period of time, it becomes natural. You feel like you were meant to be there, and it's just a wonderful place.
Now, I know you're headed back home. When do you get to see your husband and son? Was that pretty quick? Are you free to go home pretty soon?
Well, I'll see them the same day that we land, so tomorrow, an hour or so, I think, after we get back. And that'll be for a relatively short visit, but then we will travel back home together the next day. So a relatively short time between landing and getting to spend time with them.
Good. And when are you headed back to Clearwater? Everybody wants to know. I know you wanted to make it home for your class reunion. Is that going to happen?
You know, honestly, I don't know, but I'm trying to make that part of my plan. And if I can get down there for any part of the holidays, I'll certainly do that too. And I look forward to getting back there as well. I've had a huge amount of supporters, people that I know and that I have yet to meet, and I really look forward to it.
I can promise you there are a lot of people here who want to see you, people you haven't met. You've become a hero to a lot of people. This place, this area is very proud of you.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you for continuing to follow the mission. I really, it's heartfelt when I say that I appreciate the support that you've given me.
One more before we let you go. One more question. What's your first meal when you get back to Earth?
I don't know. I hope I feel like eating. I've told my flight surgeon that a nice Coca-Cola with crushed ice in a styrofoam cup would be good, and a slice of New York-style pizza would be really good, too. That's sounding good to me now.
All right. I promise you, when you get to Clearwater, if you haven't had it by then, we will get it for you, okay?
All right, I'll take you up on that.
All right, Nicole Stott and the crew of Atlantis, get her home safely and take care, Nicole, okay?
Okay, thanks again and happy Thanksgiving.
Well, welcome back, everybody. The time has finally come. We're so excited about this. We're going to be speaking with the astronauts aboard the Space Shuttle Atlantis as it orbits Earth this morning.
That's right. We're going to talk to all of them about celebrating their Thanksgiving in space today. And, of course, one of the Atlantis astronauts is Randy Bresnik, our graduate of Santa Monica High School, and he and those other astronauts do join us live right now from Atlantis. And we want to ask you guys, this is KCBS-TV, and how do you hear me?
We've got you loud and clear. Good morning.
Oh, this is so exciting for us, guys. Listen, first of all, happy Thanksgiving. And I need to read you just the irradiated smoked turkey, thermostabilized candied yams, rehydratable green beans, freeze-dried cornbread dressing. Not that that doesn't sound great, but Commander Hobaugh, that's not going to be on your menu today, is it?
Oh, there it is right there.
Shockingly, yes, I think it will be. And, you know, Thanksgiving to me has not always been about the food you eat, but the company you keep. And I'm keeping some outstanding company here. I can't wait to see my family and get back and have a good Thanksgiving meal with them a little late. But in the meantime, I've got a great group of friends, and I'm really thankful for that.
Yeah, definitely your family's all looking forward to seeing you all back down here on Earth. Can you give us an idea, how was the mission? How did it go for everybody?
Well, the mission started off with a bang, obviously, launched back on the 16th of November, and it just kept on running from there. I think it's been said several times that a space shuttle mission really puts your body into sensory overload, just one big, huge undertaking after the next, from the launch to inspecting the orbiter for any potential damage, which we had none, spacewalks, it just continues and culminates with entry, which we're looking forward to having tomorrow. So it's been fantastic. It's been a great mission from start up to this point, and hopefully it continues, like I said, through landing tomorrow.
Well, y'all look so happy to be coming home on this Thanksgiving Day. And Randy Bresnik, we know this is your hometown, Los Angeles and Santa Monica. We know that you have an extra special reason to get home and head straight to Houston to see your new baby girl born on Saturday.
Amen to that. We were just going over top of Southern California yesterday. I happened to be here on the flight deck, and it was crystal clear, and you know, you think Santa Monica and the LA Basin is a beautiful place from the ground. It's even more beautiful from up here. So we're just very thankful to be able to see that, you know, beautiful Southern California day, and you know, reminded me of home. And then of course that reminds me of being able to go home, hopefully in, you know, the next less than 36 hours, be able to see my baby girl for the first time, and looking forward to that very, very much.
I guess that being up at the International Space Station is about the best reason, and probably the only reason that I would accept for my husband missing a baby's birth.
Yeah, I can't imagine anyone wanting to miss their child's birth, but hopefully when she's older, she'll forgive me for being absent. But you know, on this Thanksgiving, we also got to remember all the military folks that are deployed around the world, because there's hundreds, if not thousands, of folks that every year go through the same thing, and it isn't just a week before they get to see their children. So you know, our thanks today goes out to them for the service that they give, and especially those who are not able to be home to see their children right away either.
And I'm kind of curious, what's the number one question your family and friends ask you when you get back down here to Earth? What do they want to know about living up in the space station and also in the shuttle?
That's still off.
I think the number one question is just what did it feel like and what did it look like?
So what did it feel like?
Yeah, good question.
Well, Nicole Scott doing a pretty great job of asking the questions for us up in space this morning, and that's a heck of a satellite delay. But, guys, thank you so much for joining us this morning. We want to be the first to welcome you home as soon as you get here. We're happy to have you, and have a very, very happy Thanksgiving.
Happy Thanksgiving.
Happy Thanksgiving.
Atlantis, this is Houston ACR. That concludes the event. Thank you.
Minutes now until Atlantis's 8:44 a.m. touchdown. Atlantis is going to be coming into range in about 3.5 minutes now of the ground tracking station at Merritt Island in Florida, which will be the primary voice and data link between the shuttle and the ground for the rest of Atlantis's flight. Again, scheduled to end now in 15 minutes. Atlantis is 37 miles above the coast of the Yucatan Peninsula, traveling at a rate of 11,000 miles per hour. Land is now performing the roll reversal that gets it back on course after its first bank to the left of 80 degrees. The second one will go now to the right, 64 degrees. This again is to continue bleeding off the speed that will allow it to touch down on Kennedy Space Center's runway 33 at a speed of 224 miles per hour. Currently, the shuttle is going 9,000 miles per hour, 13 times the speed of sound, and is 181,000 feet above the Gulf of Mexico.
Atlantis, radar tracking data reveals that you are on energy on ground track. Nav is go. We have you touching down 2,400 feet down the runway at 195.
Copy, Alfred.
That call from Capcom, Chris Ferguson, reporting that everything is looking good in shuttle in the Space Shuttle Atlantis's travel towards Kennedy Space Center. The ground track is as expected, as is the speed. The shuttle is currently 11 minutes away from its 8:44 a.m. touchdown. Traveling at a rate of 8 times the speed of sound. 5,867 miles per hour.
Atlantis, UHF only. Take TACANS, take GPS.
Okay, TACANS and GPS. Looks like range is struggling on two. We'll take them.
That call from Capcom, Chris Ferguson, indicating that Atlantis is now getting GPS or global positioning.
Atlantis guidance says TACANS should be good now.
We agree. They locked on.
As I was saying, Atlantis now getting GPS or global positioning system data for use in its primary avionics software system. That's to be used for guidance and navigation control. Unlike Space Shuttle Endeavour, Atlantis does not have the three GPS strings for redundancy. So for backup, Atlantis will use the Tactical Air Command and Navigation System, or TACANS. That's a set of instruments aboard Atlantis that receive information on the shuttle's range, elevation, and bearing from radio beacons at the landing site, and then send that information to the guidance, navigation, and control computers. Less than 10 minutes away now from Atlantis' touchdown. Shuttle is traveling at a rate of Mach 6, 4,000 miles per hour, and is currently 131,000 miles above the coast of Florida. Capcom let the crew know earlier that they could expect touchdown about 25,000 feet down the runway, 2,500 feet down the runway rather, going at a rate of 224 miles per hour. First views here of Space Shuttle Atlantis making its way towards Kennedy Space Center. It's about 7 minutes away from its 8:44 a.m. touchdown, traveling at Mach 3 at the moment, 2,400 miles per hour, still 97,000 feet above Florida.
If you like it, we'll take air data.
Atlantis, take air data.
Expert, taking air data.
two air data probes on the left and right side of Atlantis's nose now gathering atmospheric pressure data for the shuttle's onboard guidance system. They do that by measuring the speed of the wind flowing past the shuttle. Six and a half minutes from Atlantis's touchdown. The shuttle is going two times the speed of sound at the moment and is currently 86,000 feet above Florida. Atlantis is approaching the imaginary circle leading towards the runway that's created by the microwave scan beam landing system. That'll allow the commander and pilot to guide the vehicle as it makes its final approach to runway 33 at Kennedy Space Center. Commander will be taking control of the shuttle's steering once its speed has dropped below Mach 1. It's below the speed of sound. Atlantis is currently traveling at two times the speed of sound.
We actually have the runway in sight now. We'll lose it in a bit.
Copy.
Couldn't have picked a clearer day.
Five minutes now until Atlantis' touchdown. Currently 67.
Atlantis, your energy approaching the hack. No change to the weather. The winds will be all headwind, 12 peak 18. Nominal shoot.
Heard, we copy all 12 peak 18, all headwind. Appreciate it.
Seeing here the same view that the commander and pilot are seeing from their heads-up display as they approach Kennedy Space Center. They'll be performing the meeting the heading alignment circle here in just a moment, where they'll be making a 300-degree turn, right-hand overhead turn, to line up with runway 33. Commander Charlie Hobaugh, now flying Space Shuttle Atlantis, now that the shuttle has reached its subsonic speed. It's going now at rate of 625 miles per hour, currently 44,000 feet above the ground. Less than 4 minutes now until Atlantis' touchdown.
Atlantis slightly low at the 180.
Copy.
Capcom Chris Ferguson reporting on Atlantis's ground track as it makes its heading alignment circle turn into Kennedy Space Center's runway 33. Shuttle also just announced its arrival at the Space Shuttle landing facility with subsonic booms. Pilot Barry Wilmore now in control of the steering of Space Shuttle Atlantis for a moment. And now back with the commander in charge.
Atlantis, slightly low at the 90.
We agree.
90 degrees left in its heading alignment circle turn before it lines up with the runway. Now 2 minutes away from touchdown on runway 33. Shuttle still going at a rate of 355 miles per hour. It'll be touching down at a rate of 224 miles per hour. 16,000 feet in altitude at the moment. Runway 33 here in view as Commander Charlie Hobaugh lines Space Shuttle Atlantis up for its touchdown in just over 1 minute. Atlantis' speed 356 miles per hour and 6,700 miles above in altitude. Hobaugh flaring up the shuttle's nose for landing, and as you can see, the main gear of in place. Main gear touchdown. Pilot Barry Wilmore deploying the drag chute. Nose gear touchdown. Atlantis now rolling out on runway 33 at Kennedy Space Center, wrapping up a 4,490,138 mile flight to the International Space Station.
Houston Atlantis, we'll stop.
Roger, we'll stop Atlantis. That was a picture-perfect end to a top-fueled mission to the space station. Everybody, welcome back to Earth, especially you, Nicole. We'll meet you on page 5-3, the entry checklist.
Begin the post-landing. First, thanks.
That brings to a close the STS-129 mission. The 129th Space Shuttle flight and the 31st. As I was saying, the 129th Space Shuttle flight and 31st to the International Space Station. Atlantis left Florida with 14 tons of spare equipment in its cargo bay and has returned now with the cargo bay completely empty. This was the first of the shuttle missions devoted to stocking the station with spare equipment in anticipation of the retirement of the shuttle fleet, and just five more flights now. The station now has replacements parts. As I was saying, the station now has replacement parts on hand that will hopefully allow it to keep orbiting the Earth for years into the future. And although Atlantis brought nothing home in its cargo bay, the same can't be said for the middeck, which, in addition to about 2,100 pounds of returned supplies, brought back Nicole Stott, former Expedition 20 and 21 flight engineer. Stott spent 80 days as a flight engineer, 87 days on board the space station, and a total of 91 days in space. This is the last time that Space Shuttle will be bringing back an Expedition crew member.
We'd like you on page 5-8. You work rad reconfig at this time.
Okay, 5-8 for Rad Reconfig. NCC Atlantis, how do you read? Hey, great to talk to you.
And Houston, ready to open the AT on both the doors.
We're all set for that, Atlantis.
There we go. Invert for Ammoniac when it's time. I've got Bravo to Pry GPC for the message.
And Scorch, we did copy you, and that is correct. Ammonia controller, Pry GPC, Pry B GPC.
Thanks, Bert.
In Atlantis, for Butch, we do see the ET umbilical doors open, and we will take the hydraulic load test whenever you're ready.
I'll give it to you now, Fergie.
We have now some unofficial times for you on Atlantis's touchdown on the runway 33 at Kennedy Space Center. Main gear touchdown came at 10 days, 19 hours, 16 minutes, and 13 seconds into the Atlantis STS-129 mission. That's the mission elapsed time. The corresponding time for Central Time was 8:44 and 23 seconds a.m. Central. Nose gear mission elapsed time was 10 days, 19 hours, 16 minutes, and 26 seconds. That corresponds to 8:44 and 36 seconds a.m. Central Time. And the final wheel stop came at 10 days, 19 hours, 16 minutes, and 55 seconds into the 129 mission. That's 8:45 and 5 seconds a.m. Central Time.
We have you loud and clear on the speaker.
Thanks, Bert.
Thank you. start off, we had the Space Shuttle Atlantis. It was a beautiful day in November. Suit-up room is myself, Butch, Mike getting his suit ready to go, Bobby, Comrade, and lastly, Leland. Everybody's cool, calm, collected, and ready to go. Walk out through the hallway, getting prepped for the downstairs portion, which is the I Love Leland Melvin Fan Club. You can hear the fans in the background. We ride out to the pad. It's probably the first time we've ever been out to the space shuttle where there's nobody there but ourselves, and there's the suit-up guys that get us inside the vehicle. It's pretty, it's almost lonely, pretty serene. We get into the white room, which is where we put our final items of clothing on. You can see the it kind of escalates in a little bit more fun and ends up with a guy that just can't break the cord.
One guy whose wife was having a baby on our
suit up in the mid-deck. No, that's whining. Get flight deck and mid-deck all strapped in together. We get in there about 2.5 to 3 hours prior, so we're laying on our backs for quite a while.
KSC Processing and Launch Teams, wish you good luck, Godspeed, and we'll see you back here just after Thanksgiving.
We're excited to take this incredible vehicle for a ride, meet up with another incredible vehicle, the International Space Station. So with that, thank you very much for all you've done, and everybody across the country that's participated, we're ready to go.
NTD, with that, you are clear to launch Atlantis.
Copy, clear to launch.
Firing chain is armed. Sound suppression water system activated. T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 3, 2, 1, 0. And liftoff of Space Shuttle Atlantis on a mission to build, resupply, and to do research on the International Space Station.
Pretty exciting first couple of minutes. You sit there, everybody's really kind of rested and peaceful, and then towards the very end, you start cranking, getting things going, and you can tell you're going. As soon as those SRBs light, you know you're going somewhere in a hurry.
Speaking of the solids, you get up to about 150,000 feet. Solids are, the propellant's completely gone, so you want to get rid of that extra weight in those canisters. So those canisters come off, like I said, about 150, and you continue on uphill. For another couple of minutes, about Mach 13, about 300 plus thousand feet, you finally get to the point where you do a roll to heads up, where you start bouncing your communication signals. Instead of back off the ground, you bounce them off of satellites. And this is what's taking place right here as we roll to heads up. And then 8.5 minutes after it starts, the engine's cut off, and then you separate from the external tank, and you are there. You go from a light blue at launch, and eventually it just sort of fades to black, and it gets darker, and it's just a miraculous thing to watch as you get up and start looking out the window at the blackness of space. And then right after we got out, we pulled out a camera just to show each other in our orange suits. Eventually we open those payload bay doors so we can start cooling the vehicle down. And we have to do a couple of burns to circularize our orbit. And you can see fire off these burns. And you'll see those OMS, orbital maneuvering system engines in the back, just glowing brightly. Just a beautiful, beautiful sight.
Meanwhile, down on the mid-deck, we're kind of chaos down here, getting out of our orange suits and putting everything away. You can see we just have bags everywhere for a while until we get everything stowed back where it needs to go. I'm kind of lost down here underneath this piece of equipment. Bobby's playing with a drink bag there, getting out some checklists. This is flight day 2 now. We're actually getting ready to inspect the vehicle's tiles to make sure we didn't have any damage during our launch. Good looking Butch there. So these guys are pulling out the robotic arm, and I don't know why I talk about this. I'm the only guy on the crew that wasn't allowed to touch the robotic arms. I was down shaving, and here's Butch. He's got the electric version, and Randy was exercising. And then we have these big spacewalk suits that we're going to use eventually. We take those out of the airlock, stow them, and of course, there's always time for stupid astronaut food tricks. Butch needs something to do, so we told him to blow up this football.
The third day we're on orbit is dedicated to just finding station, getting there, and getting prepped for our spacewalk, which is the next day, so it's a very busy day. When we launch, the space station is almost three-quarters of the way around the Earth away from us, so we go into lower orbit and catch up to them with our lower orbit being faster. Space station just gets bigger and bigger for those full 3 days to where we rendezvous from up underneath it, do this pitch maneuver, which is really to just expose the underside of our vehicle to see if we had any type of potential thermal protection system damage, and usually it's pretty clean, but it's one last check, and this is what it looks like coming out the back end of it when we see the station again. We're basically blind on it, of course, as we're underneath it with the tile exposed, but this is the eventual end of that maneuver. Still underneath, we get to within about 500 feet before we transition to directly out in front of it, and this is an inset that actually shows the space station and our mating interface coming together, and then we'll show you a little cockpit view of the very terminal phase here of the mating.
Ready with the timer?
Ready.
Got that
coasting in.
Coasting in. 18 inches. Nine inches.
Ready?
2 inches.
Fire.
It's the initial contact. We got capture.
Capture. Everything we do is a team effort. It's all individuals working together. It's never just one person. So that's really the fun part of it, is just working together as a crew. What we were is a crew of six. Now, once we get to station and get the hatches up, we're now a crew of 12. And most of these guys, we haven't really had a chance to work with in training. We train very well together as a group of six. They train as a group of six. And now we're 12 to do this next.
So after docking to the station, we had to get to work with robotics. Here's Butch moving we call it the Waffle 1 and Waffle 2. They look like waffle cones. But they have a lot of about 30,000 pounds of spare parts that we're putting onto the space station. Express Logistics Carrier 1, which attached it to the station, to the truss. And robotics is kind of like playing a big video game. Sometimes you don't have any window views to look out of, especially on the space station side, so you have to do everything with camera views. How many video game players are in here? Okay, got quite a few. So you'd be great robotic arm operators. But we had to use the arm also to, the shuttle arm, to grapple the ELC 1 and 2, and then we take it out of the payload bay. You see it there, lots of spare parts on it. And then we have to hand this off to the station arm, the bigger arm. We call it the SSRMS. And it's a much bigger arm, much more capable arm than the smaller arm on the shuttle. And here we go. We're grappling, so we're driving the arm into the grapple fixture. And then the space station arm goes away, goes into a viewing position, and now we're going to install ELC-2. And it's a very, very tight tolerances, very difficult times, and it was a lot of fun.
We did want to take an opportunity to give you a little tour of the inside of the station. This is obviously video that's sped up quite a bit, a little shaky.
That's sped up?
It is sped up a tad, yeah. This is the Russian segment, looking at the various modules down in the docking compartment up to the newest module called MRM-2, and then turning around through the functional cargo block and then see the guys doing a little work, getting prepped for their spacewalks. On through the lab, by the space potty there. See the guys into node 2, getting closer to where we're docked to the station. We'll look right into to the Columbus module, and then back to the left, we'll look into the Japanese experimental module. Then we'll turn our way around and then back through the shuttle's airlock, which is where we obviously dock to the station. Making a lot of turns into the mid deck. See our commander there doing some water ops. Up to the flight deck. And all told, it's longer than a football field, so quite a lot of ground we covered there in about 20 seconds.
So we were getting ready for our three spacewalks for the mission, and you can see us moving one of those spacewalk suits. We call that an EMU, the big white suit that we wear when we go outside, into the airlock and getting ready. And then we are just about to start suiting up for EVA number 1. First spacewalk, there's me getting in my suit. Bobby's getting his helmet on there. And EVA stands for extra vehicular activity. That's what we call spacewalks. So So we get in these suits, and everybody checks to make sure they're all latched and buttoned up real tight, and we go outside. And on EVA number one, our first goal was to take this spare antenna that we had taken up in our payload bay and transfer that over to the space station. So that's me down in the payload bay, loosening the bolts on this antenna, and Bobby's coming over. He's riding the end of the robotic arm there, and he's coming down into the payload bay so he can take this antenna once it's unbolted and transport it over to the space station. Butch and Leland are working hard there on the video game, driving him around. Here's Bobby taking hold of that thing and moving away. And then I met him over on the other side, on the space station side, and we bolted it in, and there's a great view of Bobby.
Yeah, so Randy was inside kind of directing all of this, and coming up on the robotic arm where we were actually doing some lubing, putting some grease in there so that you can see the wire mechanism moving there. But this gives you a sense of what it looked like outside. It's in outer space, it's actually vacuum, so there's no air. That's why we have to get into the space suits for the space walks. But it's a really spectacular view. And there I am again, doing the same thing over on another robotic arm.
So then that was the first spacewalk. And then the second spacewalk was Mike and I going out, my first time. And you see how much effort it takes, a couple people to suit us up each time, get our tools on us, get prepped to go outside the door. Our second spacewalk was moving some antennas around, doing some more work with our express logistics carriers. We also installed a few other items outboard the European module. So a bunch of external work that allows the station to have better capability in the future. You can see some of these views. It's pretty amazing. If you saw them on NASA TV, the views from our helmet cams, there's a view of the commander in the window of the space shuttle, looking from the EVA person's point of view. And while we call it spacewalking, you can see that we don't use our legs for anything except to hold us in a foot restraint. It's really all walking with your hands. So you're working with your hands for all your tools and everything that you're working with. Is you also need to walk everywhere. So that's why it does get tiring, because the only thing you're using is your hands. You know, with the spacesuit inflated like it is, you're always fighting the inflation every time you want to close your hands. So that's one of the things and why we train so long and hard for spacewalks, to get in condition for that. You can see with no gravity to help you fall out of the suit, you need a little help from your friends helping you get out. And we call this one kind of like birthing the baby cow, as Butch has to stand on Mike's legs and then hold the arms up and try and push him out, because there's no force, i.e. gravity, to help him fall out.
Because my upper arms are so muscular, they want to stay in there.
But while the spacewalks are going on, there's a host of people. You saw the people inside, they're reading the script. You got the robotics folks that are moving the arm. You got the commander. His job was to be overall goalie and keep track of everything that was going on, and also do some other events. Then for the last spacewalk, Mike took the training wheels off Bobby and I, and we got to go out together. Mike was now the guy inside doing the IV, while Bobby and I went out there for the last spacewalk of the flight. And the big goal on this one was, after we installed some science platforms out on one of the big cargo platforms, this big, huge 1,200-pound tank you see in front of you, we basically, Bobby and I, pulled that off the cargo platform, turned it so that the robotics folks could grab it with the space station arm. So that was a pretty neat feat. You got this huge thing that weighs a whole bunch we'd never be able to pick up here on Earth. But you'll see how easy it is for Bobby and I just to turn this thing and point the grapple fixture up so the arm can go ahead and grab it. Obviously, when you're moving something that massive, you move kind of slow and deliberate. And Leland and Butch did a great job grabbing it from us. And then our job was to clean up a few things, and then we basically spacewalked, or did our space crawl back to the airlock so we could meet the arm with the tank and then put it in its install position. And so throughout all the practice we did in the neutral buoyancy laboratory, in the virtual reality lab, we're able to fly this thing in space on the robotic arm within inches of the install position, them using their cameras and also the views from Bobby and my helmet cameras, and then Bobby and I put it in place for it to be able to be used on station. Then after that spacewalk, we got the news that my daughter Abigail had been born. I was able to share that good news with the crew with the traditional cigars. No smoking in space, so we had the bubblegum cigars.
Now, we also had a little time to play around with the football.
That would never happen in
that
real life.
That was a great stint.
Never
great
happen in real life.
That's why Leland left the NFL.
On the serious side, there's a lot of scientific work that's going on the station now. We participated in a lot of the experiments. You can see, you saw some experiments with plants there. We also did some cell biology experiments. That's what Leland's doing right there. And we also did some experiments just measuring how much taller you get in outer space. Everybody gets taller when they go in outer space.
One of the other things we do in space is we transfer items from the station back to the shuttle, things that have to come back down, like Nicole's shoes and her clothing when she had been in space for 3 months. So here's Scorch using his legs. There's Comrade actually taking a big payload back over to the station. He's going to do his little Superman maneuver here. Here we go. He's taking it up into the top of the gym. Also exercise in space. Here's Butch working, doing some squats. Here's Scorch using the same machine to do bench press.
About 10 pounds, I think.
Yeah, it's about 5 pounds, I think. here's Mike on the cycle ergometer over in the shuttle side. And then here's Jeff running on the Colbert, which is a treadmill. The bungees help hold you down, like simulating gravity. Also, delicious food from all over the world. We're sitting here having some, I think these are calf cheeks. Yeah, some Russian delicacy. But we're all just kind of sitting around having a good time. It's, you know, you work hard during the day, you eat and you play hard at night, and just a really good moment to reflect on the day and just all the different cultures and people that we have around the world helping us do this mission. Next, we had our last transfer item, item 914, Nicole getting transferred over from the station to the shuttle. We're waving goodbye, saying goodbye to everyone, and it was a great moment. Coming back in, Jeff and the two commanders are saying their final goodbyes, and coming over, we're going to close the hatch and get back home.
All good things must come to an end, so yeah, eventually we did have to undock. But before we did, after we closed the hatch, had a little fun with water. That's what happens with water when you get in zero G. You stick your nose in it. And then Mike showing off his STS-129 ensemble. And then just prior to undocking, counting down the time, everybody's getting ready, various roles. As Scorch said earlier, it is a team effort, everything we do, so obviously undocking is as well. I was on the controls, but everybody's got a role that they play, very important. And here we go, just about
there. Physical separation.
Houston copies. Station copies.
TCS is good. Okay.
Which panels are clear. I got LBL ledge.
You fly out directly in front of the station. Eventually, we did a complete fly around. We need to do some photo documentation of the exterior of the station. So we fly completely around the station. Here the guys, our little sped up video, see how chaotic it is in the overhead windows. As everybody's grabbing the cameras, doing that photo documentation I just mentioned. Fly around the station at about 600 feet, thereabouts. And you'll see here in the next shot what the station looks like from our vantage point, and also a little sped up video there in the box as we flew around. Just beautiful, beautiful views as the contrasting of the gold of the solar arrays and the silver of the station itself and the blue earth below with the super black universe in the background is just really beautiful, miraculously beautiful views. As we say goodbye to what was our home for 7 days. Eventually we did the burns to leave the station and caught a couple of views of the earth below. Also a shot of the moon here coming up as we say bye. Looking out the windows at the curvature of the earth. So we do some more burns to start coming back home. Again, beautiful sights. That's obviously the border between Tennessee and Virginia down there.
Southern Ohio.
And there's also stickage in space. Again, fun with water and M&Ms.
We've been in space for about 11 days. Now it's time to head back. You can see gravity starting to pick up, as Leland's showing. He's not dropping his list. He's actually just letting go of it. Now it doesn't float in front of him. It actually falls. Mach 25 was the goal, and we hit that pretty well. Otherwise, you don't get this really cool blue patch like Butch has on his chest here. The landing back in Florida was great. We came screaming up the coast of Florida from south to north to a beautiful morning day. A little breezy, a little cool, but very picturesque. The landing went very well. You go from 0G to 1G, and 1G seems like 4G. Your face starts to sag, and if you had any wrinkles, they go away in 0G, but they come right back as soon as you hit the gravity environment. The sad thing about this whole event here is right about entry time is where you think, hey, we had this great crew, we had a great time, and now it's coming to an end. Kind of ends a little page in your book of true life fun experiences. After getting in, cleaned up a little bit, you get to come out and see all the guys from the top down that allowed you to have such a tremendous experience. And then the unique event here is getting to get outside the vehicle you've been living in for 11 days and seeing what held you up there. So it's really exciting.